that is appropriate. As a part of protocol, it is unacceptable for any speaker to slander or engage in character assassination at a public board meeting. So I have Kelsey or Rebecca, whoever would like to come first.
I assume I need to take my mask off while I speak?
You can if you want.
Thank you. Good evening. Thank you for having me. My name is Rebecca Kaus.
My address is 508 11th Street in Farmington. Is that sufficient?
Yeah.
Okay. I have one child currently in Farmington, Farmington schools. She is in middle school this year. I have another child that I have open enrolled in District 196, but he may transfer into Farmington at some point. Excuse me. I understand that up for discussion tonight is the ways in which this district participates in anti-racism initiatives in education. I relocated my family here about 2 years ago, this may be a little bit more than 2 years ago, from a much more diverse and much more urban area of the Twin Cities. I've noticed that in the 2 years that I've been here, the increase in population in Farmington has created a very evident increase in the diversity of the population of Farmington. I can only imagine that this will continue to increase as the population grows. Anti-racism is not a political position, and I find it unfortunate when members of any community attempt to make it one. There is no question, there is no debate, that the current education system in America was designed for white students. I think there's no shame in that. None of us were here when the education system was created. The only shame is allowing it to continue when we know that students are continuing to be disadvantaged by the system. We can redesign what education in Farmington looks like to include all students in its success. I understand that as of this year, over 20% of Farmington's student body is non-white, and that is a large number of students to potentially leave behind. For the record, both of my children are white, and I have no fear, I have no qualms about them being educated in a system that celebrates and recognizes each of their peers for who they are. I strongly believe that my children can only benefit from a comprehensive learning environment that includes things like accurate and complete tellings of history, testing language and methods that are inclusive to every student, and just an environment that celebrates our students for who they are. This type of education system would not disadvantage my white children. It would only serve to include their friends. Now, my child in the Farmington schools is a special needs child. She has a very specific disorder, and she has some very apparent differences from her peers, and she has faced a bit of bullying in the schools. And do you know what the educational answer was to address and alleviate that bullying? It was to educate her peers about her, and it worked. So I can only imagine that bullying based on racism and racial differences would also benefit and be alleviated through the same method, through education. Education is the most important tool that we have to combat any type of bullying in any form. I was so proud of this district when I learned that Vice Principal Wagner had joined with the Good Trouble Principal Pledge to work within our district to address any shortcomings or improvements that can be made to confront these disadvantages. I was even more proud to learn that we have here in Farmington an equity leadership team. I had no idea. And then I learned that one of the members was my daughter's teacher last year, who is magnificent. And in learning that, I was reassured that this work will be done thoughtfully and compassionately, because I know that he will always be sure to keep all of our students' interests in mind. I ask that this board tonight reconsider revising any policies that currently prohibit this district from standing with Mrs. Wagner and the equity team in committing to anti-racism work within our education system. It was a fantastic first step, or maybe second with the equity team, for Mrs. Wagner to join a group of other principals on her own. And I only hope to see that the district will join her in taking that stance. What a travesty if our district cannot even commit to anti-racism. It's not a political stance. Human rights is not political. We need to be the change that we want to see in this world. We know that this work needs to be done. If it's not us, then who? And if it's not now, then when? Thank you.
Thank you, Rebecca. And then Kelsey will
I wrote a different name on my card just because of like my personal circumstances as well as my career, but my name is Kelsey Jazerski. I live at 18297 Dunbury Avenue in Farmington, and I am here to speak on both anti-racism and how it's tied to the Good Trouble Coalition. So again, my name is Kelsey. My family and I have lived in Farmington for the last 7 years. This is the place that we have lived the longest, just due to my husband's active military career. Usually we're in a place 3 to 4 years and then we move on. But we've called Farmington home the last 7 years. I currently work in the nonprofit sector as a mental health therapist in domestic violence intervention and prevention. Both in my work career and in my personal life, I am passionate about combating anti-racism and promoting equality and equity. I have an eighth grade student at Dodge Middle School, and I also have a one-year-old who, at some point, will join the schools and go on his educational journey. As a child of color, my daughter has been the victim of racist bullying by her peers. She has been called Wing Wong. She has been asked if she eats dogs. She has had students pull their eyes back and other grievances and racist gestures and words towards her. She also shares with me about kids throwing the N-word around school quite constantly, and also shows me things that are posted on social media. And while I know the school doesn't have any control over social media, it tells me that it may also be transferring into the school environment. The two times her dad and I, who is white-bodied, have brought these instances of bullying to her teachers, the first time it was completely brushed off. We got met with the response of, oh, we'll get to it when we get to it. That wasn't acceptable to me, so I made sure that it was a priority. The second time, it was handled fairly efficiently just because I made sure that it was handled with efficiency. In the end, they were both addressed. However, the outcome was not what we had expected or wanted. There was a lot of justification on why it happened based off of, you know, boys will be boys, or this is their age. But in my mind, and I know in other people's mind, bullying on race is never acceptable. All students deserve to feel safe in the school, and mine currently does not. Anti-racism is just one issue that needs to be prioritized, but I'm not here to talk about that, but something that would help combat it. So several weeks ago, I was made aware that a coalition was started by a principal in Minneapolis who felt frustrated with the achievement gap here in Minnesota, and it was her goal to close it and address it. As I was reading through the list of 160 plus principals and vice principals that have signed on to it, I was encouraged to see that every single one of the schools that I attended in Minneapolis was represented. Then I saw Farmington had a representative, and I felt encouraged and I felt hopeful because I knew that someone else saw the disparities and made it a goal to prioritize equity. Then came the opposition, which left me feeling quite frankly confused. I couldn't understand how this could be a bad thing. Their focus is on closing the achievement gap by decentering whiteness. And there it is, that term right there, decentering whiteness. Oftentimes when people hear that term, they automatically think anti-white, and that's not what it is. I just want to make it known that decentering whiteness doesn't mean anti-white. It means taking white culture out of the center and replacing it with a multicultural one. This is about educational justice for all. I've also heard that if you really want people to listen, then stick to the facts, because you can't argue with facts. Well, here are the facts. According to a report published by the Federal Reserve Bank of Minnesota, the educational disparities are prevalent all over the state and are directly linked to race, ethnicity, and socioeconomic status. According to that report, Minnesota has some of the largest achievement gaps by race, ethnicity, and socioeconomic status in the nation. 65% of white students are testing at grade level compared to 28% of black students, 28.2% of indigenous students, and 33.8% of Latino students. That's half. These are just some of the statistics, and it's pretty telling in my eyes. So I guess I'm just wondering why anybody would be opposed to closing that gap. Who's it gonna harm? Is there a preconceived notion that white students will be ignored or left behind? Henry High School principal Yusuf Abdullah said, "A lot of people think that this is an anti-white movement or this is against white people, but this isn't. We think that we can all benefit from making sure that we uplift students of color and provide equity and equitable outcomes and equitable systems." Farmington schools need to recognize the increasing diversity, as Becky had shared. We're at 20% right now, and it's rising. We need to make sure that representation is a priority. I enthusiastically stand behind and support educational leaders who care about the success of all students. Thank you.
To the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you very much, Chair Doyle, members of the board, members of the community. Just a couple quick updates tonight. I know it's been a little bit since we've had a business meeting, and we've done some of this through our work sessions. But one thing that we've shared through board notes, and we've talked about a few different times, is the multi-generational space at the TLLC, which is the old ISC downtown, is finished and it is operational. And I guess it's pretty amazing the amount of use that space has gotten since Mr. Ames and Mr. Miller and all the people got that thing taken care of and up. There's people playing pickleball, basketball. It's really become a nice addition to our downtown area to really support that activeness. And once again, I just want to publicly thank Ron Ames and Ames Construction for donating a majority of those pieces of that project. And as we continue to finish the TLLC, that'll just be another really nice piece to that outdoor space. We've tried to do a couple of picture opportunities with Mr. Ames, and his sister. We have a plaque that we're going to put together, but his schedule and our schedule just haven't jived, so we're going to finish that. But I did want to just kind of make an announcement of what the plaque is going to say. Thank you to the Ames family for the generous donation to support this multi-age recreation space in the honor of the Ames family, descendants of Ruby and Chester Ames. So his mother graduated from that original building a long, long time ago, so it holds a special place to his heart. Another thing that we've been trying to do is provide COVID-19 updates. And so I just want to take a quick minute just to again, share with the board and share with our community where we're at. Last week was the first time that our Dakota County 14-day case rate finally bounced underneath 20. It had been between 26 and 22 for the previous 6 weeks. It was at 15.78, which is good news in one respect. It kind of shows us that community transmission is lessening. The unfortunate news, if you listen to MDH, it sounds like that might bounce up again. If you remember from our early conversations, people might be asking, well, are we going to look at switching learning models? We want to make sure that number is around 15 consistently for a couple of weeks before we start that discussion, because we don't want to switch to an all-in-person model for elementary and then a week later have to bounce back to hybrid. Some other just district-wide information up to this point in time. So we started school September 1st, first time that we had kids in. We've reported 19 cases of COVID-19 to MDH. And so those are our positive tests. And so those come to us in lots of different forms. And that's one of those reportable diseases that we have to report no matter where it happens. Some people may think, well, that's a lot. The good news is none of those have emanated from inside our district. They're all outside of our district. And then another thing that we've been watching just to try to figure out, you know, when should we move models and things like that, is the number of staff and students that are currently in quarantine. You know, when we first decided models, there was some, you know, feedback from the community, like you deal with the cold, you deal with the flu, you deal with those sorts of things. And that is all true, right? You know, if we have a flu outbreak, MDH is going to tell us what to do. With COVID, they told us on the front end of things. And then there's this isolation and this quarantine part of it, that even though you may not have symptoms, you may not be feeling sick, if you're considered a close contact to somebody, that bounces you out for 14 days. So as of Friday, the number of staff and students across the district that we had in quarantine, either because they tested positive, they were a close contact, or they exhibited symptoms, was 194. All right, and that sounds like a big number. It breaks up pretty evenly. It's about 2% of our staff and about 2% of our students. And again, the good news is none of that has emanated from within our district. And so, again, I've shared with the board in board notes and just kind of through email communication. I know hybrid is not the easiest thing for families to manage. I get that. It's not the easiest thing for our staff to manage. But I do think our number of isolations and our quarantine, that 194, would be significantly higher if we had more kids in our building. Our contact tracing would be much more significant. Right now, we're fortunate. If we have a kiddo that exhibits symptoms during the day, we can get them to the isolation room, get their parents to pick them up. And the way that we're organized in the buildings, we really don't have to do a ton of contact tracing because they're not within 6 feet of them for 15 minutes. So there is a benefit. So again, we're going to kind of continue to watch and see where these numbers go. I would advocate to anybody out in the community, please try to refrain from big groups and things like that. I know it's hard, but the less of we bring people together in those uncontrollable circumstances, I think the better shot we have at least of staying where we are and potentially bringing kids back in. I did participate on a call with Susan Clammer, the MDH epidemiologist and school liaison. She talked about vaccinations. Okay, MDH has to have a vaccination plan by the end of October. Right now they're planning for a limited supply of vaccinations by 2021, and they really don't think, based on the information that they're getting, that there'll be enough vaccination availability to impact schools until the spring of 2021 at the earliest. And that's even if one dose will do that. There's going to be three phases to that access of vaccine. And then another thing they're becoming really concerned about, if there is a vaccine, due to the political nature of all the things that we're involved in right now, will people get it? Is it going to be effective like a flu vaccination? There's just still a lot of things. So basically what I took away from her, that unfortunately the vaccine's not going to be a magic bullet as we continue to kind of mitigate COVID-19 through the rest of the year. And then last thing, just a good fun piece of news to share out of FES. They celebrated Hay Day earlier this week. One of the things that we're seeing in schools is that everybody has their masks on, so it's hard to interact with people. So they're making an intentional effort to greet people and say hi. One thing I found is that it's hard, but you can tell when people are smiling with their masks on, right? I can see smiles in eyes now and not faces. And so as part of that is really working on that welcoming environment and welcoming everybody. And one of the big things that they engaged in was learning how to say hello in all of the languages that are spoken throughout that building. So another entry point in terms of trying to welcome people. So they were excited about that. So those are kind of the good news and updates for right now.
All right, thank you, Jason. Then I will turn it over to Grace for a student school board member update.
So the first few weeks of school have gone pretty well for the student body. From my standpoint, what I've seen, there's definitely been some adjusting with people getting used to the new schedules and trying to figure out how to deal with all the one-way hallways and everything else. But I think that it's really helped to kind of fall into a routine. And I've definitely noticed that with myself, as well as my sister, who's in the middle school, and the other people I know from school that are in different grade levels. So I know that some of the Tiger Connections classes, which are it's like a study hall basically in the middle of the day, have been going outside and socially distancing and just kind of having some time outside on nice days to kind of have a break from being inside the classes. And I do know that many of the fall clubs that have been starting up are meeting, they're socially distanced or online to make sure it's safe. But I'm on student council as well as the debate team, and student council is working on a fall event for the students that's going to be both safe and fun, we hope. So that'll be great. And then debate just had their first tournament this weekend, and it was all virtual, so it was technically held at Wayzata High School, but there were judges online, and we held it in a Zoom type setting, so it was a little bit bumpy at parts, but we figured it out, and it was overall really fun. So I'm really glad that we get to still continue to do fun activities like debate, and I'm hoping that many other clubs will follow suit and still try to make their seasons as fun as possible while still being safe. Faith Club also had a flagpole event recently this past week, so overall just many clubs are working to still carry on like normal, but while still being safe and considerate. I know that volleyball tryouts start in this week, and other fall sports are just wrapping up, so when it's getting a little bit colder. But yeah, football is starting next week, I believe, is their first game, or 2 weeks from now. But so everything has gone pretty well, and yeah, I'm excited to be back at least partially. But yeah, it's been good.
Good. Thanks, Grace. All right, next up on the agenda is the consent agenda. And the consent agenda is made up of routine business items that can be acted upon with one motion. If any board member wishes to discuss an item, they may request that it be pulled from the consent agenda and it will be acted upon separately. Does anyone have an item they wish to discuss? All right, hearing none, I will take a motion.
So moved.
Motion by Saucer, second by Carrero. All those in favor?
Aye.
All right, motion carries. Consent agenda is approved. Then, for reports and communications tonight, we have equity leadership team, and they are going to talk a little bit about the professional development that's been happening in the district.
We have to get set up here, sorry. Just
no worries.
One second. You guys might want to close your eyes for a second.
We had it.
Thanks for your patience, everyone. Good evening. My name is Mari Deer, and I am an equity and personalized learning coach in the district through the Department of Teaching and Learning. I've been in the district for 19 years, 18 of those as a French teacher working at Dodge and Bachman Middle Schools. So this is my second year in the equity and personalized learning coach arena and my first year as a full-time person in that position. This evening, we brought with us a small part of what is equity in District 192. Tonight you'll be hearing from those who are on the presenter team, and this is kind of our steering committee. These are the folks who are most deeply invested in equity work, and you can see that they're representatives from all across the district in different levels of elementary and secondary education, as well as folks at the district teaching and learning level. Tonight you'll be hearing from Chris Cadoff, Kendra Cadoff, Natasha Gillen, Jennifer Logan Allen, Ron Williams, and Rick Yonker. In addition to this 12-member presenter team, we also have a 60-plus member Schoology group that is connected and uses that space for resources sharing and event sharing, things that can help folks develop professionally, opportunities for us to come together and have conversations around equity issues. We're also developing this year building equity leadership team groups within each of the buildings in our district and some of those staff groups. So folks are able to develop some capacity to have leadership within their own spaces in addition to the leadership we provide at the district level. Come on up, Kendra. I'll scroll for you.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Kendra Cadoff. I just want to touch on just a brief history of our journey to give just a snapshot of where we started and where we've gotten to. It's been over a decade since Farmington has began conversations around equity. And I just want to pinpoint the year of 2011 as a year that we had a solidified group. We called ourselves the Intercultural Leadership Team. It was a voluntary group of administrators, district staff, and teachers. This took us on a journey of personal growth. Equity work begins with self and really getting to know yourself first. So a lot of that was delved into, brought us a lot of awareness of equity issues that we either didn't recognize or subconsciously chose not to recognize. We did such things as book studies to educate ourselves. One particular book was Courageous Conversations that started. We did some field experiences, especially locally in our community. One such trip was out toward Hampton, and we visited the Cambodian community at the temple out there. And then we also took our initial swing at the intercultural development inventory, which is an instrument that gauges personal placement on a continuum of your intercultural mindset. And so we took that for the first time. And we did this over 6 years, and we met monthly at the high school, whoever across the district wanted to attend. But we felt that we got kind of stuck, like we were learning and growing, but it was just the small group. And we wanted to bring this journey to our peers and our colleagues. And so we decided we wanted to do presentations, but we weren't quite sure how that should look and were we ready for that. And so along with our own experiences and learning, the district brought in Dr. Carol Gupton, who is an education consultant with a vast experience of as a teacher, a principal, a district administrator, and even an administrator at the U of M. And her expertise and knowledge helped us throughout a whole year of working with her and learning from her. And so by 2018, before that, we did revisit the IDI, and we took that again. And for some of us, it was a revisit, which was great to see how we had maybe progressed in 5 years. And for others of our group, it was a brand new sampling of people who had not taken it before. But again, another entry point to see where we are as a baseline and where we need to fill in those gaps. So 2018, we decided to present our first five presentations. Some of us volunteered to be presenters. We felt brave enough that we would facilitate those conversations. And that went very well. And then the following year, last year, we did sessions 6 through 9. Again, the district supported us by ensuring that we had an hour of each session of an opportunity throughout the year. And that was wonderful for having that support and that time set aside for us to do that. We also got Mari's position as an equity personalized learning coach half time, which was tremendous help. And then this year, as we continue with sessions 10 through 13, we now have her full time. And again, just what a huge help that is, teachers wanting her expertise, her knowledge, and her guidance on where resources are and how to go about applying the stuff that we're learning. Yes, and so beyond that, you'll learn very soon about our expanded community outreach and our equity leadership teams in each of the schools.
Good evening, board and community members. My name is Rick Yonker, and I'm the science and technology specialist for our school district. I'm beginning my 15th year here in Farmington Schools, my fourth year with the equity leadership team. And I just have to say, I couldn't be prouder of our district and the work that we do together among so many things, along with the work of equity. And I'm just grateful to be a part of it. I wouldn't be anywhere else for any amount of money. I love our district. One of the things that we take real seriously here in Farmington is our strategic plan. And I just have to say, I've been honored to be a part of developing the strategic plan twice, and most recently on an action team where we collaborated with community members, parents, people outside the schools and inside the schools, principals, teachers. And this is part of our strategic plan. And the reason that we bring this up, and I want to read out loud. Normally I don't like to read slides out loud, but it's so powerful that we believe that every person has inherent, immeasurable worth, that each person deserves respect, that communities thrive when all individuals are engaged, and human diversity enriches both the individual and the community. And as we've worked as an equity leadership team and looked at How do we train? How do we talk about this? How do we have conversations? Really, the heart of what we do, what really drives what we do in so many aspects, is our strategic plan. We take that very seriously. And you can see here that, again, Farmington Schools will grow in its ability to appreciate cultural and individual differences and create bridges between all students, staff, and families in the greater community, to nurture an empathetic culture with a shared voice that creates and strengthens relationships in our community. And what you hear is what we do, and it really drives what we do. And I'm so grateful to be a part of conversations and buildings. I've worked with sharing the equity presentations at Aiken and at the high school. And really at the heart of it is relationships and conversations. At the heart of it is seeing that we're all on a journey. And because this is such a collaborative effort, we're able to connect with teachers, administrators, and others, and really have dialogue about what this means and what we need to do to grow and develop and continue to support understanding the importance of connections across cultures, and to communicate in a way, like what was said earlier, to continue to be an amazing district where we create a safe place where we can talk about issues that are really hard to talk about. And so I'm just grateful to be a part of it, and thank you for inviting me here tonight.
Board and community members, thank you for having us. I'm Chris Katoff, I teach at Farmington Elementary. And I'm gonna talk a little bit about the ELT and the connection of equity work to our work in the classroom as teachers. So we talk a lot and have been for years and do a lot with personalization and personalized learning. And we believe that equity work is essential to that, and it's a core component of individualized learning. So at the heart of it, we believe that it's not an add-on or something else, but it's just part of what we do. It's part of our curriculum. It's just what happens in our classrooms on a day-to-day basis. Continuing what Rick said a little bit about the connections and the relationships that we've formed through presentations in the buildings, that's the key for me and for us with students, and getting to know them on a personal level, building relationships, making those connections, finding out about their race and their culture and their ethnicity, and how that part of their identity is a part of their learning as they sit in front of me. It also asks us to look at ourselves and where I might have biases and what areas of privilege that I might have and how that might affect how I look at students or how I act with them or treat them. So to be aware of those things and confront them and act on them. To look at others and have empathy as we have differences and recognize and celebrate those differences. And again, all of those things just help to meet learners and students and families where they are, and so that we can try to provide the best education and experience that we can for them. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Natasha Gillen. I'm the EL teacher and EL coordinator for the district. I currently teach at Riverview, but I've taught in most of the schools in the district. I've been here for about 17 years, and our data starts 2003. I started in 2004, so I feel connected to this data. So in 2003, we had only 5%, this is kind of about our why, of why we've been doing this work. We had only 5% of our population were students of color. That population has changed, and now in our district we have 21.8%. So as I've been working as an EL teacher, I've really benefited from classrooms where my classrooms have diverse opinions, diverse students, diverse religions, and I've really benefited from that diversity. And I'm really excited that that our population is now gonna get to benefit from that. So part of that, we need to build our cultural competencies as teachers so that we can really pull that out of our students and build that understanding.
So you'd probably like to know how we do this. And the equity leadership team is driven largely by that 12-person presenter team, folks from different educational spaces, of different backgrounds, of different races and ethnicities. All of the content that we generate for our staff development presentation, so anything that goes out to our staff, the content, the activities, any of the videos that we show, are researched, created, and then approved by that 12-person team. So there is no one person who is solely responsible. We find that what that does is hold us all accountable to each other, but it also means that that's a pretty big table of folks who are participating in the creation of that professional development. So we've got a ton of diverse opinions that are represented, and we want that to be a balanced approach to the content that we're providing. We don't source any of our curriculum from outside of the district. We also don't have any presenters from outside the district. These are people on the presenter teams who have built a relationship with the staff in their building or in their staff group. They are the ones who go out several times a year and engage with teachers and staff and administrators to deliver those sessions across the district. We do center voices of color in our presentations. Many of us identify as white educators, and we do recognize the importance. We're very humble about our space. We recognize that in a human business of education, what we are trying to do with our staff is not tell them how to think, but provide a variety of perspectives so that people can think about some of those pieces that the other ELT presenters have talked to you about tonight. How do my perspectives affect how I show up in an educational space? What am I bringing to the table that might get in the way of a child having a successful experience here? How am I shaping my classroom space so that every child feels seen and heard and understood and celebrated and honored for exactly who they are? So in that respect, we center voices of color and the experiences of our learners and our families. We use examples that we hear. We center those voices when we look for pieces to share with our staff. That is essential to us. The content is adjusted for each audience if it's needed. So if, for example, we have a concept that everyone should know about, but it looks a little different at the elementary level than it does at the secondary level, we will adjust that, and then people who are at the elementary level provide feedback about that to us. The content's also created based on staff requests. So especially in the last few months, we've heard people say, I really want to learn more about this, or I see these things happening in my classroom, in my building, and I want to be able to help, or I need support in this particular concept area. So we look at that, and we purposely do not define any of our professional development until we get feedback from the last presentation. So that's content that we develop based on what we hear from staff and the things that we think we need from our community and also from our staff requests. I should say too here that Minnesota has now required a cultural competency component for relicensure. So in order to be relicensed in the state of Minnesota, educators have to undergo 8 hours of cultural competency training. Both Kendra and myself and several others, I think, Natasha and Chris also, right? Okay, and one or two of our other ELT presenters are presenters through Education Minnesota, but our presenter team also counts. So our staff now is able to count the work that we do here towards their relicensure. So we find that to be positive and good. I should share with you too a little bit about the work that I do through the Department of Teaching and Learning. Lots of times when you say equity and personalized learning coach, people are like, what is that? And it's cool because in the Farmington way, we have a lot of freedom to build what that needs to be, and it's in response to the needs of our community and our teachers. I approach the role with a lot of humility, with a lot of willingness to learn, and my job primarily is building relationships between different staff members, making connections with the community, connecting folks to resources, and both maybe print resources or curriculum resources, and human resources, and also to build capacity so that folks are able to start to do some of the concepts that we talk about in our professional development sessions in the classroom and in their own educational spaces. Sometimes that's resources, sometimes that's guidance in the form of conversation or coaching. I also do a fair bit of creating and sourcing professional development with the Equity Leadership Presenter Team. And then I also reach out and connect and collaborate with other metro area equity leaders so that we have some connections to what other folks in the cities are doing.
Thank you for having me, Board, and good afternoon. Good afternoon to the community. My name is Ron Williams. I've been in the district for 14, 15 years now, and I've seen a lot of changes as we moved forward in this work. I was invested in this work from day one when I stepped foot in the district. And to see it culminate to the points that it is now, I have one word for it, simply amazing, amazing. But what I'm doing in as a sidebar to the work, along with Ms. Deer, is that I'm reaching out to the community to find out where is this disconnect that we have with our students of color and the district. So as you can see, it's pretty much established. I'm not going to go verbatim by each line, but during the summer months, I heard a lot of feedback from the community in relationship to the district and what we are doing to level the playing field for their students of color. Let me be specific. And so over the summer months, I kind of brainstormed with Ms. Deer and collectively kind of came up with an idea to kind of get some feedback from the community. And that entails outreach meeting, going out to the community, sitting down with the families, email, what else did I leave out?
Phone calls. Email
and what's the last name?
Phone calls,
yes. It just eluded me.
Dude, old school.
So much in my brain, it just eluded me. But as I heard it said, but by any means necessary, getting this information in. And then once we get this information in, we can start to compile it and see where the pluses and the negatives are to improve the system. And that's the real crux of what this outreach program is going to go on and do. We started the work. We sent out some information to the communities of color and trying to find out what we need to make that better. Now, let me be very specific. This is not just going to be in one category or one particular group of people. Eventually, it's going to be collected to all the families and students here in our district. But I'm excited about the work. I'm excited about seeing what's going to turn out so we can better manage this situation that we have going on in our country today. So thank you for that time, for your time and everything.
Hello, my name is Jennifer Logan Allen, and I work at Bachman Middle School as an interventionist. And I'm going to talk to you about the work that has been done over the summer and is continuing to go on this year. So as Ron and Mari kind of noted right before, they have been working with community ed and providing, because they had heard from the community about their interest in delving into this, you know, equity work. And so they created sessions where they had discussions, and they're going to continue those this fall. So they're going to be doing a book study. They're going to be reading, let me just check my notes. They're going to be reading So You Want to Talk About Race, and then they're going to discuss that. So that's one of the ways that as a community in a macro sense, they're kind of hearing what needs to be done and then filling that need. Additionally, Mari continues to always seek out new information and learn more herself, because we all understand that this is an ever-growing, you know, situation where we need to be learning just like we ask our students to learn. And so she's going to be doing lots of professional development opportunities herself through Teaching Tolerance and other ways, and then she brings that forward, and that informs her work and therefore informs the work that we do as well. Then that also kind of brings us to the development of building team capacity and leadership. So in the time that I've been a part of the equity leadership team since 2017, I've really seen the capacity grow. It started out as a smaller group of highly passionate individuals, and as it, you know, grew, the momentum grew. And more people within the school started to understand and learn more and become even more passionate as well. And so it is something that now we see that movement happening in our schools. It happens in the small ways when you have a conversation one-on-one or in small group with other teachers who are just talking about these issues. We've seen it with book clubs. We have small group book clubs. We have larger group book clubs. This year at Bachman, Kendra has kind of led the charge to bring in book clubs. And so we're going to be reading or engaging with different resources that deal with issues of equity, and teachers get to choose. And then there's going to be monthly discussions around that. Additionally, last year, Mari helped to create different lessons that went into TCs. What we were finding at Bachman was, as a mother pointed out earlier today,
you know, kids are not always using the language that is, you know, sensitive. They are not always, you know, able to kind of, you know, bring that sense of understanding of others into the classroom. And at Bachman, we noted that. We saw that happening. And so Mari was able to, with the collaboration of many people on the team, create lessons that went into DC. And we were starting to build, you know, lessons around empathy and understanding and equity. Unfortunately, due to COVID, we had to put that on hold. But this work is something that is building momentum and is becoming really centered in our buildings. And then that brings us to the teacher level. So teachers are, through their IGDPs, through those growth plans that they themselves are looking at, what do I want to look at when it comes to equity? How do I want to bring that into my curriculum in a personalized manner that then, you know, we hear it in a big sense, how can I physically act that out in my classroom? And so we're providing opportunities for teachers to do that. Teachers are learning more. So that might look where you have a language arts teacher that is going to do, you know, work around finding voices of color who are, you know, people who are writing different literature and bringing more voices of color into their classroom or things of that nature. So I am really, I feel very privileged to be a part of this group, and I feel very humbled by the work that we have done. And I think that it is something that has had such a value. And my role in general as an interventionist, I see how important it is for every individual kid, especially at this time, to be seen as an individual and to have their needs met. And so this work helps to continue that. Thank you.
That is the end of our official presentation, but I am happy to take questions if you have them, or if you have something that any of the presenters have shared with you tonight that you'd like to ask. Of course, you can certainly do that. I want to send out, too, that if there are things that you'd like to learn more about that might take you longer than we have available tonight, I would welcome conversations with anyone about the work that we do and how we engage in that. This is a process that community and board, we have a really big table in the equity world. We're into being open about what we do. We have many, many people who participate in this work because that's the work that makes it stronger. It's really about hearing those stories, understanding where folks are coming from, understanding ourselves, and then bringing the best of those things to the educational experience that we have here, because this is about humans, and I don't think there's a person in the room or in the community who doesn't want the best for kids. And what we're looking at is the ways that we improve our craft and who we are in that educational space, and how we ask staff to think about those things and engage in the work. Thank you.
Does anyone have any questions?
I'm here.
Yes.
Awesome work. I just have to say, you know, given what we have seen happen in our community, especially in the last 6 months, I'm going to talk in my glass, I'm going to take them off. I think having sensitivity to others, but like you guys had, many of you guys had mentioned, for those of us, having some self-awareness of our personal biases is so important. And I think that what you guys are really doing, focusing on those things to provide what's great for kids. I think the only thing I would challenge this group to do is, as part of that is the community part of it. And even if it's not an outward reach of people should do this, but you guys are providing resources to teach, like book clubs and that kind of stuff. Reading White Fragility or listening to the White Nice White Parents podcast, eye-opening, because again, it just highlights good intentions, but not necessarily recognizing our biases. And I think having awareness of things where we can have that out for parents and community members to go, just read it, right? Or just listen to this and be open to hear what you can hear. Because sometimes just taking that first step is great. And I think as you guys work with the kids and the students and the people working in this district, there's that last community element that is crucial to us changing. And just as you guys do this work, please continue to do that. But I would say, if there are things that we can just put nuggets out there or share with families, that may not necessarily think that that's their forefront, but we are the ones that are going to reinforce what you guys are looking to do. And the more that we are educated is going to be huge. So thank you so much for what you do.
Of course. Thank you.
Madam Chair, I concur to everything Julie is saying. I mean, it's amazing to see where it started and where you're at now and where it continues to go. Kudos to all of you guys involved in that.
It would be interesting to get more involved with the community. I think the community needs to be educated. Every time you guys speak, I get educated on something different. And I know it can be a touchy topic for some people, but it's nice to speak openly and have the conversation. And I mean, I think this would be something, a topic to even start instituting in like certain things, like even athletics. I know Bill speaks to the parents and the kids, and I know Coach Fisher does a great job in doing that as well. We had parents speak tonight, which I thought was fantastic. The more we can get the public educated, even have you guys attend more. I love when you guys, you know, attend these and come to educate us on different things that are going on within the district. So, but again, if there's anything we can do to support that even more, push it further, let us know. But great job to all of you on that.
Thank you.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
I don't think I can add anything more than what Steve and Julie just said, other than just adding my own thank you. This is always an important topic to talk about and discuss, but now more than ever with everything going on across our country, it's important that our staff and our students realize that equity is important. And just knowing several of the staff members that presented tonight and that were on that list, I know this is a passion of your guys's, and thank you very much. And Maury, I think I've known you now for 13 years, and I just going back to day one, I knew this was a passion of yours, so thank you very much.
You can see the passion in all of you that speak on it.
Madam Chair, I have a couple questions, and I know that the superintendent has been great to share with us some of the ideas, some of the topics you have covered in professional development, and sure. I know that that's a broad topic, and to ask you to highlight those right now would be a lot. But could you highlight a couple of maybe the most recent things you've worked about with the professional development team that has trickled down to the teachers and also influence how that also might be taught with to our students?
Sure.
And it's been diluted a little bit, but just looking for a little more meat.
Yeah. Sure, absolutely. So we really, I can give you a broad overview, if that's all right. We really started with the understanding that an equity journey begins with an understanding of ourselves, our own race, our own ethnicity, our own culture, and to be very grounded in that. So we started with a lot of identity work with staff, and then also some work about our why. So some of the information that we shared with you here about our demographics, about the need to be able to connect with folks whose races, ethnicities, and cultures differ from our own, the need for that to be a skill that we bring to the educational space. We did a lot of work with personal culture. So where we come from, where others come from, that idea that, I was gonna say one of the things that we worked with staff was a cultural iceberg. So those things that you see on the surface versus what's deep down underneath and what folks are navigating, especially in situations where they may be the only person who is of their race or ethnicity, et cetera, in a space, and what that's like to understand and empathize. So we did a lot of early work on identity and culture to develop that within our staff. We moved on to some concepts, and we asked folks to consider colorblindness, the idea that you don't see color, that you see all students. And again, with some context, the idea that we want to see, we do see color, right? Kids as young, even very, very young kids see that and notice it. And to notice that and talk about it and celebrate it. Because sometimes I think, as Mr. Carrero alluded to, these are hard conversations. We're not used to having conversations around race. Sometimes that's something that's we tell kids to, you know, we don't talk about that. But then they get the idea that that's not a good thing to talk about. It's just who we are. So we talked about that with staff. We asked them to consider that perspective. We have done some work around windows and mirrors. So how do kids see themselves reflected in the classroom? What's in the physical space? Are there posters? Is there student artwork? Can kids see folks of all races represented in your curriculum? We had folks go through an equity audit to kind of look at their own practices and say, these are things I do often or sometimes or never, and how do I break out? How do I start to make changes so that kids can see themselves reflected in not just the physical space of the classroom, but what we read about and do and talk about? We've asked staff to engage in some discussions around privilege and bias, so looking at those kinds of things. We've asked staff to engage in, oh gosh, somebody help me out with like this year or last year. What's that? Yep, we've asked staff to consider the ideas too, especially this year, of anti-racism. And we know that that kind of is a topic that some people can go, I'm not sure what that is. To us, what it simply means is that we are against racism in our educational spaces. And what we are looking to do is challenge ourselves to take action at every turn to interrupt that, and to be folks who will say, wait a second, that doesn't sound right. To be people who are the folks who step up when things are said in the classroom and to address it, and to give teachers the tools to be able to lead those conversations with their students. That's a pretty broad overview, but if you want to connect later, happy to expand on that.
Madam Chair, one other question. We have the group here that spoke talking about the good trouble principles. Can you speak to that, and maybe in any involvement that the ELT team has had with that group, or if that's something separate, or just if you can address that, that would be great.
Sure, absolutely. As far as my understanding is concerned, the good trouble principles are a group of principles. And so largely as a group of teachers, that is not something that we are engaged with or a professional learning community that we are part of. It was created this year, so based on a lot of our history, our work predates that. It's something that I believe principals have an opportunity to be part of, and it's a way for them to hold each other accountable for their engagement in equity work. That is not something that currently has bearing on what we do. We are supportive of many of the ideas, but that is not something that influences our particular professional development with staff at the moment.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
I have more of a statement. Like Steve said too, and Jake, excuse me, Mr. Curtis and Mr. Perro, I always love hearing you guys and where you're at, you know, and doing your presentation. I would love for you guys to come back, and I always feel like you have to do a presentation, but just an update of any, you know, aha moments that you're seeing in classes, or successes, or even some, you know, we couldn't quite jump over this hurdle, but we found a way to make it work.
Sure.
Because I think it's very, very important to hear that too. And also your community outreach, I think, is huge.
Yep.
And so I would love to get more frequent updates on where the group is at, and wonderful work.
Absolutely. We'd be happy to do that. I will say that personally, one of the positives this year when we ran our sessions, we ran them some virtually and then some in person. And because of distancing, we weren't able to do some of the breakout sessions that we usually do where teachers can meet and talk with each other and have conversation. So we used what's called Padlet. It's like a giant wall that's has digital post-its, basically. Mm-hmm. So people can post anonymously to questions. And I will say that when all of us got responses from the Padlets this year, and we talked about where are folks in equity after the past 6 months, what are you thinking about, how are you reflecting on the events of the summer, how are you preparing yourself to have conversations about this with students, because we know they're talking about it. We know that's coming to us, and how are we going to handle it, right? In a way that honors their experience and doesn't traumatize them and makes certain to be aware of all of the experience of all of our kiddos. I was floored by the growth in the comments that people were making from the time that we started to the feedback that we got from those questions there's been considerable growth, and lots of folks are talking about it. Lots of folks are reaching out to us for support and wanting to kind of humble themselves before the learning and do better. So.
Thank you. Thank you to all of you.
Thank you.
For presenting.
Thanks, everybody.
We appreciate it. All right, with that, then, I will take a motion to acknowledge receipt of reports and communications.
So moved.
Motion by Carrero, second by Coletta. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Next up is our administrative action, and Jane is going to talk about the preliminary tax levy.
Well, good evening, Madam Chair, Board Members, Superintendent Berg, Member of the Communities. I'm here to wrap up our conversation regarding our preliminary levy, which is our Pay 21, which funds our 21-22 school year. If you can remember, on September 14th during our work session, we talked more specifically about what makes up our levy and the differences from the prior year to this year. And remember that when we're talking about tax or our tax levy, it's just part of our formula. It's only half. A lot of our revenue formulas have an aid and a levy. Aid comes directly from the state. Levy comes from our taxpayers. And the revenue streams that are in our tax levy are set in statutes. So it's not like we make these up. It's actually guidance that is provided to us from the legislatures. So when we look at where our levy is standing now compared to where we were on September 14th, there are three areas that we had adjustments on. Two of them were in long-term facility. Another one was in our debt excess. And they all had to do with corrections at the state level. It had nothing to do with what we did here at the district. And so when we're looking at this, we had an originally on the 14th a 3.7% increase. Here we're showing a 4.23, but we need to remember that that 4.23 represents an increase in revenue. It doesn't necessarily reflect the increase that a home buyer or our community members will see on their taxes for their house. And actually, with some very preliminary information, and I said preliminary, and depending upon the value of your house and how it compares to everybody else in the community, even with this 4.2, a lot of people could see taxes of zero, or they could even see a slight decrease. So because, like I mentioned at our previous meeting, we're a growing community. Our tax base, our referendum market value, and our net tax capacity, which are what the basis for most of these formulas, has increased greater than what our increase in revenue is here. Now again, that's preliminary. So I don't want anyone coming back and saying, you said it's preliminary information, but there's a good chance, you know, depending upon the value of your home, that you might not see an increase in your taxes this year. And so what the administration is asking is that we actually approve the levy for the max. And the reason that we do that is the state is still refining formulas. It's 41 pages of calculations. It's a lot of information. And so what we usually do is every September, we go for the max, and then we come back that first meeting in December to fine tune it to exactly what it's gonna be for our district. So at this time, I'll take any questions anyone might have.
Madam Chair.
Yeah.
So can we hold you to that statement a few seconds ago?
No.
I just had to ask. That crystal ball is looking really nice right now.
I know.
I appreciate that. I'm just joking.
Madam Chair.
Yeah.
But as you stated, kind of the approximated estimate pieces, we'll have a lot more information as far as the impact come December once you get all. So again, this is just setting the preliminary piece, but
yes,
the more detailed information and actual tax impact on our community members will be in,
yep,
December.
Yeah, and I've already connected with Ellers that once we get some more definite concrete figures to start doing some calculations like we did last time to say, well, on an average home of $250,000, you could expect this sort of increase, decrease, or whatever it may be. So we'll be able to have that information there as well.
Thank you.
Yeah, I do have a serious question. Regarding some of the numbers in here that you were just kind of waiting on, we talked about reemployment numbers last time. And I know we're, if we certify this 4.23 tonight, is there any odd that that could be a lot higher? Or is this the max that we can do it this year from this pre right now?
No. So what the administration is asking is that we don't certify a specific number, that actually in our levy we will put maximum. Because one, we don't know what our unemployment is yet. Unfortunately, there hasn't been much ground movement on that at all. And for example, if there's another error, you know, what if all of a sudden we go down to 3.2? Well, we don't want to be locked in at 4.23 because that's what the board approved. We want to be able to give the state that flexibility to write, refine their calculations until December.
Thank you.
Yep.
Any other questions? All right, with that, I will make a motion.
I'll make a motion to certify the proposed property tax levy payable 2021 as maximum and set the truth and taxation hearing date for December 14th, 2020 at 6:30 p.m.
Second.
Motion by Singwald, second by Cordes. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries. Thank you, Jane.
Probably be my at last voting action as a board member, too. Mm-hmm.
All right, then next up we have policy action. We're gonna be talking about Title IX, and I believe Ms. Marianne is going to come up and go over that with us.
Good evening, Chair Doyle, members of the school board and community. You have before you tonight the revision to policy number 522, Title IX, sex, non-discrimination policy, grievance procedure and process. As we talked about at the last work session, due to some changes in the Department of Education at the national level and the Office of Civil Rights, there are changes that are being required of educational institutions, including K-12 education, to handle harassment claims that are that fall under Title IX and the definition of Title IX. So it's a pretty broad policy. It's a very complicated procedure, but luckily it's a narrow procedure. Not very many harassment claims would actually fall under Title IX, but those that do fall under Title IX, there is a very prescriptive process that we will go by to investigate and make decisions about the outcome of the complaint under Title IX. This policy does name our Title IX coordinator. We'll be posting this policy, we'll be putting it in handbooks, notifying all of our employees about the policy. I'd be happy to answer any questions that you have, but it is a pretty lengthy and complicated policy, so I won't try to actually walk through it. Any questions I can answer?
Madam Chair. Just more of a comment than a question. I know a lot of this is, you know, it's a law, so we need to put this into effect. But typically in policies, we don't typically list names and positions. It's typically more of a procedure piece because those names and positions change. So right. Just in term of approving this tonight and going forward, if those people or titles change, we'll have to go through and revise this each time, correct?
Correct, yes. Okay. But the only one that we're describing is the Title IX coordinator and the alternate Title IX coordinator.
Okay.
And not by person, but just by title.
Okay, yeah. That makes sense.
It is unfortunate, but we do have to.
It's odd for a policy to be so constrictive, but I understand that that's what was passed, so.
Yeah.
Thank you. Any other questions? All right, with that, I will keep a motion.
Go ahead. I'll make the motion to adopt policy 522, Title IX, sex non-discrimination policy, grievance, procedure, and process as presented.
Second.
Motion by Carrero, second by Cordes. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Motion carried. Thank you, Marianne. All right, then now we have board remarks. I will start with Grace, if there's anything you would like to say before we...
I would just like to say thank you to the ELT team for presenting. It was really interesting to hear about all the different levels of the district that are being affected by the work that you guys are doing. And yeah, it's really interesting to hear about that. So thank you.
I will just say a shout out to the district staff. The work session that, you know, there's people here tonight that may not have heard or, but the work session that we had last time with all of the COVID planning and replanning and more planning and changing, it just demonstrates the challenge that this year has had and the flexibility and the resilience that this district staff has had in really adjusting to our new norm for this year and trying to find the best path for our kids. And so I've heard a lot of positive things from people in the community on how things have gone and the options that have been offered to families. So thank you for the work that you guys have done on that. And then it's just been really fun to see some of the things that have been highlighted from our district in taking the new challenges. And so I'm just gonna call out, it was really cool to see the girls swim and dive program highlighted on the news in the last week also. You know, super excited to hear that some of these other groups are being able to find ways to participate, like Grace highlighted tonight. Some of the rest of the fall sports are actually gonna get to have a season and kids aren't, you know, multi-sport kids aren't gonna have to choose, but it was really neat to see them get highlighted for creating essentially an audience or fans in the stands that can't necessarily be there. And so just watching our community come together and find creative ways to create a unique and awesome experience for these kids, because I think many of them go through their educational careers, educators and students alike, with expectations of what I think is coming. And nobody could expect what was coming this year. And watching people really drive new ways of doing things, and in my opinion, sometimes better. I mean, sometimes some of the things that we've seen, I would say even in the last 6 months, have lended to things where people are like, we should really think about what this looks like after this, because there was a lot of things that were better. And so I just, a huge thank you to all of you, because it's been a lot of work. Very, very appreciated by a lot of people navigating something that can feel scary or uneasy. And so much thanks. So thank you.
Thanks, Julie. Melissa?
You know, that's kind of some of the things I was thinking about, is I just wanted to thank all of our staff and administration, every part, piece of the puzzle that make things run here, because I know that they've been working hard, and I love all the creative solutions I've seen. It was exciting to see the marching band make things work and get their one final show that they worked just right beforehand to get done and do that. There's just so many examples from how Community Ed has changed programs, to many online classes, there's countless examples of creativity and personalization that have been done in our district to highlight. That's amazing. And I know it's been tough, and I know it hasn't been easy because everything is different, but I just want to sincerely thank all of those involved in each individual, because it's been a lot of work, and I know it's been successful at this point, and continue to keep it up as we continue to modify what the new normal might be like next week.
Thanks, Melissa. Rebecca?
I think we all kind of have the same thought process, because that was one thing too that I was thinking about, is this school year and how it's been going and how the kids have really adapted to it, and that shows. And a lot of credit goes to the teachers, the educators, the principals, everybody involved. And I was thinking about band this year and how band was gonna go, and even those band teachers have really stepped up their game, and boy, let me tell you, those band students have, you know, they've got a lot on their plate right now, and it was really neat to see how they are doing virtual lessons and resolving that challenge that they had. So really ditto to everything that has already been said. It just goes to show you how strong our district is.
Steve?
I agree. I guess the biggest thing to me is it starts with the top-down leadership. Jason, you're doing a great job. And then trickle-down effect with all our principals and teachers. Boy, this is driving me nuts. I'm sorry. You know, and I don't think people realize the hard work, you know, that all of our educators do, all of our staff members throughout the district, you know, like Jane and Dan this morning,
were on a call at 6:45 in the morning talking about stuff for finance, and Julie was on it as well. To our teachers preparing classes every day and over the weekends just to get our kiddos going. Big thank you to them. It was kind of nice to see pulling up to the school tonight, all the activity going on, kids coming out of the high school. I haven't seen that in a long time. Also, driving around the district during the days, it's kind of neat to see some of the classrooms that are outside, how creative our teachers have gotten. Equity team, great job tonight. Again, kudos to them. Our speakers tonight, I thank you guys for coming. And continue to send us, you know, school board members information where we can reach out and help. Also, I know we have some people that are running for school board. You know, I met with some of you. We're here to help you guys in any way possible. Reach out to any one of us, and appreciate you guys, you know, throwing your names in a hat to run for school board. It's a key position, and it's you know, during times like this, you can sit back and say, boy, this is something that you would never expect, but it's nice to have great leaders in place to lead the charge on this. I mean, we're just the people in the background, you know, watching this happen. So again, thank you to Jason and the administration. And that's all I have.
Jake? I think everything that I wrote down before has been stolen, so I'm just gonna briefly echo the thank you to district staff and administrators, teachers, everybody for being flexible with what Jason is calling the normal of now. Is that what you've been calling it?
I stole it from somebody.
Okay, well, I'm gonna give you credit. The normal of now, but in addition, thank you to the parents and students for their flexibility too. It hasn't been easy, I think we all know that, but they've been dealing with everything that's been going on very well as well. Again, thank you to the EL team and our speakers from during public comment tonight. Thank you for everything you shared. And normally this is something I'd probably say at the last meeting in October, but because election day has now become like election weeks, I'm just gonna remind people to get out and vote. Whether that's early in-person voting, absentee voting, or voting on election day, it's a big election. And like you said, we've got several people here running for school board, and it's a very important position. And you know, get out, do your homework. Thank you to the candidates who are running, and to everybody else, get out and vote.
All right. Yeah, I really can't say much right now without being completely redundant, but I do appreciate the teachers that come in and speak, but not even that, but just knowing that you guys are volunteering for the things that you're doing and going above and beyond, and we have so many staff in the district that are willing to do that, and to the community members that come and actually take the time to educate us a little bit too and take time out of your night. So thank you for that. The one other thing I'll say, the next thing on our agenda is to go into closed session. When we come out of closed session, the only action will be adjournment of our meeting, and that won't be recorded, but just so the public is aware. But that is all I have. If anyone has anything else, okay. Then
I'll make a motion to move to closed session pursuant to Minnesota Statute 13D.03 to discuss labor negotiation strategy after a 5-minute recess.
Second.
Motion by Singwald, second by Cordes. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.